Well, thank you all for coming, and I'll be talking about something a little bit larger than what either of the other two have talked about. I'm going to be talking about some anatomy, and because we have no time, I focused on one portion of the anatomy, which I think is particularly important in terms of the divergence between chimpanzees and also gorillas and humans. And then I'm going to wrap it up with implications for that anatomical difference. So here is the primate phylogeny, and I put it in this position because I want you to see that, as Pascal was mentioning, you can see how closely related we are to Pan, both Pan paniscus and Pan troglodytes, versus the rest of the non-human primates. Yet, to understand something about our own behaviors, I think we have to look at the other non-human primates because in many ways, they have things that are more similar to us than our own close genetic relatives. Now, what I'm showing you here is a comparison between the pelvis and the femur, and that's the area of the anatomy that I'll be focused on, is the pelvis and the femur. And I want you to see how different the two pelvis look. These are innominous, just half of it. But the human is shrunk shorter, it's broader, and what you'll see in just a minute, and compared to the chimpanzee, which has a long blade-like innominate, it's just the shape has changed completely with very little genetic change. The other thing, I'm going to go back to that, the other thing I wanted to emphasize is the difference in the size of the round thing there, the acetabulum. That is the area in which the femur actually articulates with the pelvis. And it is huge in humans compared to what it is in the ape. And I think there's some very good reasons for that. When we look at the comparison up at the top, I think it'll give you a better sense. It's as if our pelvis has wrapped around in almost toward the front. So it's, whereas the chimpanzee pelvis, the blade is up the back. And so it has a very different distribution of musculature, even though that it is the same set of muscles. Down below here, you see, is there a pointer? Yeah, you see the gluteals that you see there. As you know, those are the ones that allow you to go upstairs, do any kind of hiking in the mountains. You use those muscles in order for propulsion in that kind of instance. Whereas the chimpanzee has it in a different position and can't serve as propulsion in quite the same way. This is actually a gorilla, but it's the best one I could find that would show you. I'm amazed at the difference between the musculature of that gorilla and of a human. And it's the same for chimpanzees. They have huge muscles compared to what we have. And it's not just because we don't work out all the time, although that's probably part of it. But it is true that there has been genetic changes which have decreased our musculature compared to the non-human primates. So you see where the gluteus maximus, the two gluteals, minimus, medius, and maximus are on us. They wrap around the pelvis. You're looking at the side. Here, they're just going across the back. And these other muscles that are then coming out around on this portion of us are the ones that are wrapped around this way. And you can see, well, we won't go into the leg at all. So I just wanted to show you something of the human gait cycle and also of the stride cycle, because it is completely different in the chimpanzees and bonobos. See how they straighten out their legs, completely straight. Won't surprise you, because that's exactly what you do when you move. But the point of this is that there are periods of time right there, right there, right just about again, and when this, right there, right just about there, that you're carrying all your body weight on one foot. So all your body weight is going through that hip. And so your muscles are set up to be able to stabilize that. It's not just the gluteals that allow you to walk up the stairs. It's the adductor muscles that you practice when you do balancing, that they grab on the side of your hip. And the chimpanzees and bonobos can't do that. So for an example I want to show you, this is a female bonobo. and she's going to be walking upright. You can see that she's standing upright with a completely straight torso on top of her hip. But that's not going to be true of her knees, nor is she going to be able to balance on one leg without throwing her whole weight over on that side. We can do it with the weight with our legs right underneath us. This female bonobo is not able to do that. So what you get is this kind of motion. You can see how she's moving from side to side, moving her weight around that. That's because she has to grab muscles on the back of her hip that we would have on the side of our hip. And so she's in a very uncomfortable position, even though she's doing this, because she wants to carry that tool. So in order to do that, she's standing upright. Now, the other thing is, we won't go into the hand, but just, it's a great picture of the hand, and I wanted you just to see that for the last point I wanted to make.
So this is the presumed locomotor sequence in our evolution, and the thing that always shows up is this knuckle walker here. So bonobos and chimpanzees are knuckle walkers. Gorillas are also knuckle walkers, but they do it completely differently than chimpanzees and bonobos do. Orangs also walk on both their front legs, but they do fist walking. So although we've combined all these apes into one locomotor situation, it's completely different. So how did it all come about? And what was our ancestor like? And when we split from the chimps and the bonobos. Now this changed all of our views, and for those of us who kind of like that view, anyway, we were just thrilled by this. This is Ardipithecus. She's from 4.4, it is a female. She's from 4.4 million years ago in Ethiopia. The people who found her, which is Tim White and his crew, made the science story of the year in 2009 with the find of this. It's an incredible fossil. She has a pelvis that's similar to ours, not similar to the gorilla or the chimpanzee. So 4.4 million years ago, we were already demonstrating a pelvis that was far more similar to what we have today than to either chimps or bonobos. When you look at how she was reconstructed, in terms of where she was standing, she could stand upright. Now, her hands are much more like that bonobo in that she could use the trees. Her feet were able to hold her upright, but she could grab on a limb. So she maneuvered differently than we do, but this is not a knuckle walker. And many of the animals that preceded her were not knuckle walkers either. So my suggestion is that this is the possible locomotor sequence. I'm not about to say that this is the locomotor sequence. But there are certain numbers of ways you come down from the trees, and one of those is on a flat hand. Now, if you grow big, you have to do something to allow yourself to stand upright in an at least usable position. And one of them is knuckle walking. One is fist walking. The other one is what I think Ardipithecus did, which is stand upright from a flat fist. That has certain implications for a lot of what we see today in our behavior, and that's how I'm going to wrap this up. I'm going to try to do this very quickly, and it's. But when we look at overall primates, what we see is that there is a body size constraint on what you can eat. So across primates, you have insect eating, you have leaf eating, and you have fruit eating, which you cannot just do fruit because you're going to need a protein source. There's nitrogen in fruit, but not much usable protein. Now, when you look at this, you also have large primates are over here, small primates are over here. What you have are small primates can exist on insects. No matter how many insects you want to find, unless you hit a swarm, you're not going to hit very many. So a big animal can't survive on an insect unless they're eating only swarming, and that is going to be seasonal, highly seasonal. So large primates end up eating leaves. And they need an energy source, a quick energy source, and that's fruit. And so a lot of primates end up being frugivores, insectivores, or frugivore folivores. Now, you try to figure out what our diet is. It doesn't fit at all. And there are no primates that rely on leaves and insects. And if you think about our diets, our leaves, lettuce, isn't going to give you much of anything because you don't have cellulase and you don't have a large amount of microbiota to break it down. So we have a very different diet. So how did we get around that constraint this way? What we did is we have hunting. What you're seeing here is a zebra. These are the Hadza of Tanzania that I was fortunate to work with for a couple of years. In the background, you have sociality. So you have the women and some of the younger people in the background. And also, you have development of tools and technology. And CARTA will be having a public symposium on that in October of next year. And so putting that all together, here's the man with the tool. With the tools and the technology, the sociality, and that is absolutely required, you end up coming from a different kind of locomotor background, and I think I would suggest that part of the reason we are what we are is because of the way we ended up coming down from the trees. Thank you.